I'd like to introduce you to carbon-13 NMR spectroscopy. With proton spectroscopy, we were seeing protons. With carbon-13 NMR, what we're doing is seeing carbons. And like proton spectroscopy, you can see that different carbons will appear in different locations on their correlation chart. Now, there's a couple of differences between carbon-13 and proton NMR. Well, the first one is that we're looking at carbons, not protons. Secondly, if you look at the scale, we're looking at about 0 to 200. So the scale is about 10 times what it was for the proton. But the carbons that appear in the carbon NMR appear in approximately the same locations as those protons would that are connected to those very carbons. It's sort of relative on the correlation chart. So something that is attached to a C double bond O in the proton NMR would be about 10, this one's at about 200, so it's about 20 times what it would be in the proton NMR spectrum. Now we have two directions we talk about. We talk about downfield, which is towards higher ppm, and upfield, which is towards lower ppm. Upfield we have the alkyl Cs, that is the Cs that don't have anything attached to them except hydrogens. And CH3s will be pretty close down here near zero. Cs attached to C double bond O's will be around here, about 20 to 30. Then as we add more electronegative groups, you can see we get more downfield shifts. So a CN is around 40, a CO is around 60, a CCl around 60 as well, CBr around 60. C triple bonds are about 80. C double bonds move into about the 100-110 range. Cs that are part of aromatic rings will be around 120, and Cs that are part of C double bond O's will be around 200. You'll notice the trend here, electronegative atoms, C attached electronegative atoms down here, C attached to double bond around here, C attached to aromatics around here, or C part of aromatics around here, and Cs that are part of C double bond O around here. The other thing that we have to deal with is symmetry, and we dealt with this with protons, and in the proton case we were labeling protons. Now since we're looking at carbon-13, we're going to label carbons. If this were a proton spectrum, we wouldn't label this one because there's no protons on it, but since we're looking at carbons or carbon-13s, we're definitely going to look at everything that has a carbon associated with it. So if we're going to label this one, since there's no symmetry here, we just label it A, B, C, D, E, F. This one has symmetry straight down the center. So it would be labeled A, B, B, C, C, and D, all around the line of symmetry. This one, again, we've got symmetry. So it's A, B, C, B, A. These two are identical due to the line of symmetry down the center of the molecule. This one also has a line of symmetry down the center of the molecule as well. It's harder to see because that's an aromatic ring. But this would be labeled A, B, and there's a carbon here. That's C, D, E, F. Remember, we wouldn't have labeled this in the proton since there's no hydrogens connected to it, but in the carbon we definitely label it. And the thing is, we're going to get as many peaks as we have letters once we finish putting letters on, and that takes into account symmetry. So this one has 6, this one has 4, this one has 3, and this one has 6. So we get one peak for each different kind of carbon that we see in the compound. So here's an example of a carbon-13 NMR spectrum. A couple of other things you'll notice about it when in comparison to a proton NMR is that with the proton NMR, you'll notice that the lines here are a lot flatter. This is very noisy, what we call a very noisy baseline, because of the way that it kind of goes up and down like this, very thick baseline. And that's due to the fact that carbon-13 only makes up 1.1% of all carbon. In the case of proton, 1H makes up almost 100% of all hydrogen. So those spectra tend to be a lot less noisy. But due to the fact that we really have to push the sensitivity up to see those 1.1% of carbon atoms, and then we get much noisier baselines on our spectra. So now you can see that we've got one different peak for each different carbon atom in this molecule. We have A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. And you can see all the aromatic ones, A, B, C, D, appear up here between 120 and 150. So that's typically where you're going to see aromatic carbon atoms. These other ones, E, F, G, and H, all appear down here. Now the other thing that we see is that the closer that a carbon atom is to an electronegative source, or in this case a ring, the more downfield the shift will be. So the E will appear here, the F appears here, the G appears here, and the H appears here. So as we get closer to the ring, the shifts of the peaks will be downfield. The other thing we have here is a solvent, CdCl3. It's a very common solvent. It has a triplet peak at around 77 ppm. For all intents and purposes, you can pretty much ignore that because it is just a peak for the solvent. If we take a look at the aromatic region here, you'll notice there are four peaks for the aromatic region. We have one here, and one here, one here, and then one here. This peak has been expanded. You'll see that the peak range is between 120 and 130, and that's what we're seeing, between 120 and 130. And you see this peak, which is A, and then this peak, which looks like a single peak, is actually two peaks very close together. And these two peaks represent B and C. Now the reason that B and C is taller than the peak due to A is because there's two B and then there's two C's and only one A. So these tend to be about double the size of those. And then you've got this one here, which is peak D. You'll find that over here. The other thing that also can affect peak size is the number of hydrogens attached to that particular carbon atom. And it turns out usually that peaks with more hydrogens attached to them tend to be taller as well. That's a very... That rule is kind of loose. Sometimes that happens, sometimes it doesn't. All right, a couple of other things you'll notice is that these all are single peaks. And the reason these are single peaks is because the coupling to hydrogens has been removed. Now, these do couple the hydrogens, just as we saw with the proton NMR coupling to other hydrogens. So these are, in reality, multiple peaks, but if we set up the conditions in the spectrometer, that is, we saturate the magnetic field with radio waves, we can actually make those into single peaks, and that's what's been done here. Now you'll notice there are letters above each of these peaks, and these letters represent what the peaks would look like if we didn't include the decoupling. Let me show you what the coupled spectrum looks like, that is, if we didn't saturate it. Right, here's what the coupled spectrum looks like. You can see there's the quartet here, the four peaks, and there's a triplet here. And now you've got these two triplets, but they're really close together, so you're getting a lot of overlap with the peaks. And here's your aromatic region. So with the coupled spectrum, you get to see a lot more peaks, but it's a lot more confusing as well. So what we tend to show is a combination of the coupled spectrum, which shows the coupling to the hydrogens, and the decoupled spectrum, which doesn't show the coupling to the hydrogens, it just shows the single peaks. And that will give us pretty much all the information that we need. Now the rules that explain the coupling is, if you've got a Q, that's four peaks, so that means it's a CH3. And the rule is, if there are N peaks, then there are N minus one hydrogens attached to that carbon atom. So four peaks is a CH3, three peaks is a CH2, two peaks is a CH, and one peak is a C. And the abbreviations we use are Q for quartet, T for triplet, D for doublet, and S for singlet. And the reason we do this is just for straight clarity of the spectrum. So we get all the information about what kinds of hydrogens we're actually dealing with and carbons we're dealing with, but we don't have to deal with all the overlap that we experience with the spectrum that we've got over here. All right, so let's just make sure you understand what I'm talking about with the Q's, the D's, and the T's, and the S's. And we've got a Q here because this is a CH3. We've got T's here, here, and here because these are all CH2s. We've got D's for A, B, and C, and that's because those are all CH's. And this one doesn't have any hydrogens on it, so that's a singlet. So D is a singlet, but that's what we see over here. All right, that concludes my introduction to carbon-13 NMR.